Hey everybody, I just want to take a moment to talk about a new thing I'm doing. Over the years, many of you have reached out to me telling me how much you love the podcast, but also wish there were more personalized takeaways and more in-depth interactions with our guests to hear what they think about comedy. This is why I'm now launching my new digital academy, Blueprint for Success. With exclusive interviews and comedy philosophies of stars and industry veterans, personalized versions of the industry standard podcast, commercial-free, and one-on-one coaching time with me. Blueprint for Success will give you the powerful tools that will take you up the elevator beyond the competition and reach the highest possible levels to achieve your dreams. Whether it be stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, hosting, radio podcasting, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or an agent. Now I'm here to help, personally. We'll go on an express train of comedy and entertainment like nobody else has before. You can find out more about Blueprint for Success and the comedy business on my website at barrykatz.com. Together, we'll take your career where you want it to go.
I mean, this moment, like, being free, doing what I want to do. This transition, this summer, has been my proudest moment.
Welcome back to another episode of Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. Without further ado, I will introduce my guest today, who I am more than excited to introduce. So let's go. Sasheer Zamata is a comedian, actress, and writer, best known for her great work on Saturday Night Live the last few years. She received improv and sketch training from the Upright Citizens Brigade Theater and performed stand-up at colleges and clubs across the country. She's appeared on People of Earth, Transparent, Inside Amy Schumer, and Totally Biased with W. Kamau Bell. She co-created and co-starred in the web series Pursuit of Sexiness, which was named one of the top 10 web series by Variety magazine. Sasheer has been listed in Cosmopolitan's 13 Funny Women to Watch, Time Out New York's Top 10 Funniest Women in New York City, and Brooklyn Magazine's 50 Funniest People in Brooklyn, and Complex Magazine's Women in Comedy You Should Be Paying Attention to Right Now. She's performed at the most prestigious festivals in the world, including Bonnaroo, South by Southwest, Moontower, Sketchfest in San Francisco, Vodafone, Bridgetown, New York, Brooklyn, Limestone, North Carolina, Great American Comedy, Women in Comedy, and the New York Comedy Festivals. Sasheer's first stand-up special, Pizza Mind, premiered on CISO. She stars in the films Slight, Yoga Hosers, The Outdoorsman, and Deirdre and Lainey Rob a Train. She's done incredible voiceover work for BoJack Horseman, Call of Duty, Albert on Nickelodeon, and the Lucas Brothers Moving Company. She also serves as the ACLU's Celebrity Ambassador for Women's Rights. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my guest today, Sasheer Zamata.
Yeah, you got
all
it.
All right, I did it. I feel so strongly today. It's odd, but there's something about you that's transferring to me, this power.
Yeah.
I know you know how talented you are. I know you know what you're capable of. I know you know what the landscape is, and I know you know this business is filled with doubt, which is the greatest career killer of all time, but there's something about you that screams to me that you have the power to always overcome all the times when this business breaks your legs.
Wow. I mean, yeah. I think so. I feel like I've had my legs broken, so I feel like rejection is a thing that has built up a kind of thick skin, I guess.
Do you remember the first time you are doing something in this business where you felt rejected.
Yeah. After college, I went to the University of Virginia, majored in drama, and I was doing improv. And I took a semester and a summer to work at Disney World. They had a Disney college program. And I thought I would stay in the Disney family. I was like, oh, I'm already in the system, so maybe I'll work at Disney more. And I was on some listserv that would send out casting calls for different things. And so there was one for a big band jazz singer at Tokyo Disney. I've never been a big band jazz singer before, but for some reason I was like, this is it. And I didn't have any post-graduation plans, but I was like, this seems like a cool thing to do for a year, and then I'll figure it out after that. And so I was in Charlottesville, Virginia, and I took a Chinatown bus to New York to do this audition. And this is my first real life audition that wasn't like a school play or something.
You took a bus from Virginia to New York.
Well, I drove to DC and then took a bus from DC to New York. Yeah.
Could you tell the audience what the material was for the audition for Tokyo Disney World?
We had to sing a song of your choice. And then we had, there was a dance portion where they would teach you choreography and you would do it. And I was so green and just truly didn't know what I was doing. But I had my sheet music for Open Arms. That was like my go-to singing audition song. And because I knew that dancing was involved, I was like, I want to look cute, but also comfortable. So I had these yoga pants and like a cute pink top or something. But what I didn't know is that you do the singing portion first, dressed up, and then if they ask you back for the dancing portion, then you change your clothes. So I'm looking at everybody else in like heels and ties and dress shirts, and I'm like, why are they going to be so unprepared for the dancing portion? And then realize, oh, you change. So I look like a slob compared to everybody else. And then I did my singing audition, and it was fine, I guess. I mean, the piano was going way slower than I wanted it to, and I kept tapping my thigh to like make them catch up to me. But that's not what you're supposed to be doing. And yeah, the casting people were just like, okay, thank you. And I was like, but what about the next part? And they're like, that's enough, thanks. And then I left, and I was just crying down the street, calling my dad, like, that was it. That was my plan, and it's gone. And I don't have any plan, because I knew, I was positive that I was going to Tokyo Disney, and I wasn't. So I just went back home, or went back to Charlottesville to finish school. And then lived in Maryland with my ex-stepmom for a few months and, like, worked at Starbucks.
You're ex-stepmom.
Yeah, because
I've never heard that before.
Yeah, well, she was my stepmom, and then her and my dad split, and now she's technically my ex-stepmom. But, and I guess I could say my stepmom, but I have had a stepmom after her, so she's my ex-stepmom.
In those relationships, is there always a point in time where you're heard uttering the sounds from a hallway, "You're not my mother"?
I don't think I've ever said that to her. We did have a rough patch when I was younger, because they married when I was 11, I think, and I lived with my mom, my biological mother. And yeah, I did have those feelings of "you're not my mother," and I was a real bitch. I was real shitty to her for a couple years. And then eventually, I'm not sure what changed, but I started to like her, and she was like a cool other parent I could talk to who wasn't my mom or my dad. And she was really great at advice. And then when I was 18, her and my dad split, and I was like, oh, fuck, I don't know what to do, because I just started liking this lady and I love her. And so I called her for her birthday that year after I found out they had split, and we just talked for hours. And she was like, you can keep calling me if you want. And I was like, I think I will. So I kept calling her, and then yeah, I just chose to keep her in my life. And that felt like the first real adult thing that I ever did, where I was like, I'm making a decision to make this person stay. I don't have to, you know, live the way that, like, whatever else is going on in my family, it doesn't matter. Like, I know I love this person, so I want to keep her around. So, yeah, I invited her to my graduation, and then, like, would visit her as much as my parents. And after I graduated from college, I didn't want to live at home back in Indiana where my mom is, and I didn't want to live with my dad. So I lived with my ex-stepmom.
Was your dad friendly with her still or no?
I think cordial. They didn't like talk or anything. And they didn't have kids together, so they had no reason to continue talking.
Everybody wants love. Every song on the radio, it's about either finding love, losing love, or getting crushed by love. Mm-hmm. A person who's looking for love, it's like they board the plane, you know, whatever kind of plane it is. It could be a little prop plane. But they crawl out of the wreckage. They dust themselves off. They limp out of the wreckage, and the first thing they say is, where's the nearest airport? But you would never do that. But with love, you always do that.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering for you, when you witness these situations where people are in your life who are your parents and step-parents, they're searching for love. They find love. They lose love. Then they go back again. How did that affect you in your relationships and love?
It greatly affected me. I remember telling my dad that seeing his movement between women, and he's, if you met him, you'd be like, what a charming man. What a like nice, upstanding citizen of society. But he has married a lot of women and been with a lot of women. I don't know how he treats the women he's with in the relationship. I've never seen him, you know, be abusive or anything like that, but like he has cheated on people and like not been the best example of a partner, and that built a lot of distrust with me and made me really wary of men in general. So I didn't start dating until I was 23. And because the idea of meeting someone who could be great, could be a great guy, seem honest, and then one day realize, oh, he hasn't been honest this whole time, or for a period of time he hasn't been honest, that was scary to me. I didn't want to even try to do that. I didn't want to participate in that, because it just, even thinking about my mom, like, I don't know. There was probably so many other things going on in their marriage that I don't even know about, but you know, to my 9-year-old self, it seemed like one day he woke up and was like, I don't love you anymore. And that's terrifying, that you could fall out of love. But I didn't understand that concept. I was like, well, when you're in love, you're in love. And that's it. So you should just be together forever. But there's tons of other things that are in a relationship that have nothing to do with love. And it complicates things.
Hey, everybody. I hope you're enjoying this episode as much as I am. If you made it this far and you haven't fallen asleep yet, then you must be the type of person who's serious about having a career in the comedy business. That's why I'm offering you my blueprint for success, a one-of-a-kind all-access pass into my knowledge and experience after over 40 years of working with the best of the best in this crazy entertainment industry. I'll tell you all the stories, all the philosophies, give you all the great special guests, and even give you one-on-one private consultations to help you expand, enhance, and skyrocket your comedy career. Just go to barrykatz.com and click on Blueprint for Success to learn more about my groundbreaking digital academy that I've created just for you. With it, we can take your career so far that one day, instead of listening to this podcast, you'll be interviewed on it. I mean, had to be a special guy to have you finally say, all right, I'm going to let go and let God, or whatever it is, I'm going to go with this, and this is the guy I've chosen to start my journey with.
We went to the same college together, and we dated after college, but we had a lot of the same friends in common. He seemed great. He was like, he was very smart, and I don't know, he was great on paper, and in my mind, I was like, I should just try it to see, I don't know, just to see what it would be like to be in a relationship, to like let go a little bit.
So you had no attachments. You weren't saying to yourself, whoever I choose, that's gotta be the one, that's it.
I guess I thought like, oh, this will be practice for another relationship, which I can't imagine he would like hearing that. But you know, it was like, I just figured there would be another one at some point in time, so I should try it now to know what it's like. And if this one works out forever, that's great too. But I should start trying. I'm in my early 20s and I haven't dated anybody yet, so I'm missing out on a lot of just life experience.
Did you crush him or did he crush you?
Huh. I mean, I broke up with him, but I felt crushed. Like, it felt like he made me break up with him because it was probably bad timing. It was probably a lot of things. It was like, he just wasn't a good boyfriend to me. And I'm sure he is now to somebody else and probably has been a good boyfriend to other people before me. But at that time, we probably both weren't fulfilling each other's needs. And so I'm the one who broke it off. And the energy I received felt like, good, I'm glad you said it so that I wouldn't have to do it. And he wanted to be friends afterwards. And I was like, nah, man, I can't. I can't do that.
Do you think sometimes when a woman does break up with a guy, she wants him to fight for her to get her back?
Maybe sometimes. I think it's particular to the woman. I didn't want to get back with him. I really did want to stop being with him because I wasn't happy. And I was like, I don't want more of this. And we had talks. It wasn't like, I've never done anything where I just like cut something off cold. I never quit a job or like broken up with somebody or like a relationship or a friend without a talk before, because I want it to get better. I want it to do well. So he should have known that I wasn't happy already. And then it didn't change. And I was like, well, it should end then.
People in their personal lives, a lot of times, it mirrors what happens in their professional lives. I remember Sherry O'Terry telling me about how she felt on Saturday Night Live. She did 100 episodes, and every day that she started the week, she felt like she was auditioning for the show. You take somebody like Tracy Morgan. I could say this if Tracy were here. I represented him for many, many years. I think Tracy had a little bit of Farley in him. Not the horrible addict, not the guy who was a wrecking ball of joy, but almost was just like, I'm just here and I'm oblivious to the fact that I'm not doing well. And I'm just going to be friendly and jovial to everybody and hopefully this will turn around. Even did a sketch one time where he's these are my highlights of the show, and it was all him waving goodnight. But the point I'm trying to make is that when I was around SNL, Will Ferrell had no attachment to any political thing that happened. Now, it could be argued, well, that's because he got on all the time. He just did not care what anybody thought of him. He just had no fear. And I found that in that show, and in most jobs, when you have no fear, you have a better shot of navigating through the craziness. And when you're walking on eggshells, wondering whether you're going to make it or not, that's when things start to go haywire. And so, regardless of being SNL or any of the things you went into, do you feel like you went into them in a way where, you know, I'm going to try this, I'm excited about it?
Yeah, I think so. I think I try my hardest to be like open and game to change and figure out how to be, you know, malleable to the situations. But then after a while, it's like, oh, okay. If I, after a while, after trying, you know, you got to realize, oh, I'm not the problem. And then get out. I think I have approached a lot of jobs like a relationship where, or and maybe not on purpose, but just like if something's not working, my go-to is to talk to somebody. And that's how I do it in relationships. Something doesn't feel right. We should talk about this. and see why. Because you might be thinking something that I don't know about, or vice versa. Maybe I have an understanding that you didn't know, and we need to be clear on that. That's how I like to operate. But some people don't. And then you got to decide for yourself, am I willing to work with this person who doesn't speak my same language or doesn't want to be as open and honest as I'd like to be?
There's only one person that speaks your language as an artist. You.
Sure, but there's people that you can find who can understand your language.
That's true. When did you know that when you looked in the mirror, you were like, oh, I'm more special than maybe the average person in terms of comedy, and looking in the mirror and saying, I love what I see. I love myself.
That I love myself part took a long time. I don't know if I can even think of a particular time when I was looked in the mirror and was like, yeah. I mean, when I was younger, I've had like so many issues of self-doubt and confidence issues that I've been trying to work through. And I'm like, I seem very confident, but I grew up very shy. And sometimes I'm still fighting that voice. It's like, who do you think you are? Like, why do you think people need to hear what you have to say? But, you know, that's quieter than it used to be. And I don't know if I've ever thought that I'm more special than anyone else. I think I would, I don't know. I think that would maybe like hinder what I do a little bit. If I started to think like, I just am better, because maybe I wouldn't work as hard. But I don't know. I feel like I got where I am right now because I worked really hard. And also like opportunity and being in the right place at the right time and et cetera, et cetera. But I also worked a shit ton. And that's not something that I would do if it was like, if I felt like I have a gift and I'm special. It's like, no, I need to work to learn how to write and create and express myself and find my voice and get it out to the people so they know what I can do.
What was the first thing that you created or did where you got done with it? And even you, who might have been filled with doubt, you came home, you sat on the couch in the fetal position, and you said, I did it. I cracked the code.
I don't know what the first thing is, but I can think of a couple things. One was my improv group doppelganger. It was me and two other black ladies. This was at UCB. And I was doing improv with Nicole Byer separately, and I was doing improv with Keisha Zoller. And then I suggested that we all three improvise together. And we still are a powerhouse. We still perform together when we can. And when I perform with them, it's like, we are unstoppable. Like, it feels like electric, and we bring the best out of each other. So that, and so we would get off stage and just really feel like I left it out there. Like, I left everything out there. We did everything we could possibly could, and it felt great.
When you're with three people,
speak my language.
How do you alternate the straight person?
You know, we kind of never did. Or no, we do alternate sometimes. But most of the time, we kind of fall into the same pattern. So I'm usually a straight man, which I love being the straight man.
It works for Ben Stiller very well in Ice Cube.
Totally. Yeah, I mean, I feel like sometimes there isn't as much love given to the straight man as, you know, the person who's being wacky and loud and stuff.
Who is the funniest person in Seinfeld, in your opinion?
I mean, I would say Elaine.
Who was the second funniest person with the most laughs?
George.
And who was the third funniest person with the most laughs?
Kramer.
And who was last?
Jerry.
And who made more money than anybody else?
I mean, Jerry. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
So you're in a good place.
Yeah. But I also struggle with that too, because during improv classes, I would get notes that would be like, be bigger, be louder, be like, you know, go outside your comfort zone. And I was like, I feel like what I'm doing is funny, but I guess not. And then I finally had a teacher who he himself is a straight man and is really good at being a straight man. He saw what I was doing and was like, oh, here's a better way to do what you're doing. Here's a better way to be a straight man. And I was like, thank you. That's what I wanted. That's what I would prefer. I mean, it's nice to be like, you know, you can do other things and like have range, and I have range, but what I like doing is wrangling other people and like kind of dancing around that they're crazy.
Tell our audience what it takes and what are some of the qualities that you were taught to be a great straight. When I say straight man and you're a woman, do women say straight man?
You know, I guess I still say straight man too. I think some people's perception of what a straight man does is stopping the fun. And that's not what we're doing. You're not stopping the action and being like, wait a minute, let me call out the logic here. You're calling the logic out, but you're still allowing the fun to happen. So you kind of have to identify what the game is or what the theme is, where you're going. And then like egg it along enough to be like, I see what the crazy is. I'm calling it out, and I'm the eyes of the audience, and I'm kind of telling everyone why it's ridiculous, but I'm allowing it to happen because it should happen. It'd be so boring if it stopped.
Tell me a time when you came back home, got on the couch in a different way in the fetal position, and you put your head in your hands and you're like, God, I have a lot of character. I'm a great person, but I think I was a real asshole today and I did something really bad. And I got to figure out how to clean that one up.
Which story will I tell? There was one time when I was starting off at improv classes and I wanted to desperately feel like I was part of this community, and I was, but you know, people didn't know me, I was new. And I remember talking to a teacher, and I don't even know what we talked about or how long we talked, but I left the conversation feeling so horrible. I was like, am I awkward? Like, is something wrong with me that it didn't feel good? And I can't imagine he felt good afterwards either. And it made me question everything. I was like, maybe I should just quit. I suck. And then it took me a while to be like, oh, everyone else is awkward. It wasn't me. I mean, I can be awkward, but like, we're all neurotic in some sort of way. So once I realized that, navigating people in this community was much easier. But yeah, that was definitely a moment where I was like, am I bad? Can I not hack it here? And then, I mean, so many times at SNL when I went home and was like, yeah, I don't know what is wrong. I don't know what the thing is, even, or like there was an interaction, or like maybe I was too blunt about giving a note, or maybe I was confused about a sketch and we never really got to an actual answer. Yeah, but there's so many things where now I feel a little freer, where I'm like, I don't care. I mean, I care, but like, it whatever. I won't remember this in a few years, or I'll look back at it and be like, oh yeah, I was really upset at that thing, but it's fine.
Hey everybody, let me remind you one more time about my new blueprint for success. It's a project I've spent months and months working on just to help you jumpstart your comedy career and beat the competition. Whether you want to do stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, radio, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or agent, Blueprint for Success will give you all the tools you need to take your career to the highest levels. With exclusive interviews, my top 50 commercial-free episodes from Industry Standard, one-on-one coaching with me, and unprecedented access into my knowledge and experience from over 40 years in this crazy business. I guarantee you that with Blueprint for Success, you'll become the creator you've always dreamed of becoming. No one's asking me to do this. I want to do it because I want to help you become truly undeniable.
So just go to barrykatz.com, click on Blueprint for Success, and start your incredible journey today. I truly can't wait to work with you to help you change the trajectory of your comedy career forever.
I want to go way, 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 way back.
Okay.
So I want to just talk about where you grew up.
Mm-hmm.
What was the socioeconomic dynamic? How many kids in the family? What was happening growing up until the point where you talked about before? And then what was your first inspiration of getting into this crazy business?
Yeah, well, my dad was in the Air Force, so we moved around a bunch. I was born in Okinawa, Japan, and then we moved to San Antonio, Texas, and then Hampton, Virginia, Riverside, California.
Is that why you wanted that Disney Japan gig?
I guess so, yeah. I was already used to traveling, and I did want to go back to Japan just to visit my roots. And I still haven't been back to Japan since I was 10 months old or something. So I would like to see it as an adult. I'll get there. But yeah, we moved around a bunch. And then my parents split when I was 9. And me, my mom, and my brother, who's 7 years younger than me, moved to Indianapolis, Indiana, because her sisters live there. And I had a lot of cousins there. And then my dad moved to Maryland with his new wife, my ex-stepmom.
How many days a year did you spend with your dad?
I think maybe a week or two in the summer, and then Christmas.
So essentially 2 or 3 weeks a year you only got to spend with your dad.
Yeah, from like 10 to 18. Some people get less. But yeah, it was a drastic drop. And I mean, that whole process was bad. It wasn't a nice divorce. It was pretty ugly. And people didn't say really nice things.
I always say happy ex-wife, happy life.
Well, she was not happy. And yeah, and that I could see it. I could see everything. I mean, I probably didn't see everything, but I saw enough to have it negatively impact me. But also, like, I don't want to be like, my parents ruined everything. But, you know, it wasn't like they didn't do a good job of hiding how much they really didn't want to be with each other and disliked each other. And then, yeah, I mean, and my relationship with my dad is way better now, but it took a moment because we had this very surface relationship for such a long time, because when we saw each other, we'd try to be on our best behavior and be like, this is it. We only have like a couple weeks to cram in as much family time as we can. And so it wasn't real. And but now I feel like since college, like, especially when after I opened up about how viewing him and men in general affected me, we've been way more honest with each other. And you know, now we're like adults. We get to talk to each other like adults and like people and realize that we are people. It took me a while to realize that parents are people.
And the first inspiration to getting into the business?
My volleyball coach. Oh, I did tons of activities. Basketball, track. I was in show choir, orchestra. I was in the honor society, prom committee. Like, I just did so much. Partly because I wanted to like get scholarships, because I wanted to leave and go to a different school out of state.
Is that how your guidance counselor tells you get scholarships as you join all these different clubs?
I mean, not specifically, but I think it was like, if you have good grades and you look like you are an active member of the school community, then yeah, you have a better chance of getting scholarships. So I had good grades and I did a shit ton of stuff. So I did get a lot of scholarships.
What inspired you?
Well, in high school, I watched I Love Lucy all the time. And I watched Mad TV and SNL and thought it would be so fun to be on a show like that.
When you were watching Mad TV and SNL, which one did you like better?
Mad TV. It was more pop culture. It was more like, you know, all like singers, and you know, they're parodying Britney Spears and Whitney Houston, and I maybe leaned younger, and where SNL was so political, and I didn't care about that at the time. So, yeah, it was more... Mad TV appealed more to me at the time.
Which cast members on Mad TV moved you?
I mean, Deborah Wilson is number one. Like, she is so funny. And it was just great to see a black woman be hilarious and, like, kind of rule the cast. Like, she was in so many sketches and had so many characters and is, like, so talented in so many nuanced ways. Like, she could be so big, but also, like, have really small, detailed actions. Like, I don't know. She was a machine, and I loved her.
When I opened my comedy club in Greenwich Village on West 3rd Street, simultaneously, the old Village Gate, the 400-seat room, opened up their room with a group called New York Talk. And Deborah Wilson was one of the stars of that group. So was that your first inspiration in the business?
Yeah, I guess so. But at the time, I didn't really think that I could do that. I mean, I thought, like, I would love to do that, but I just didn't even know how those people got there. So it didn't cross my mind to even try. I was like, well, that's great that that exists, but I don't know how to do that.
When SNL was really female-centric, where it had Anna Gasteyer and Sherry O'Terry and Molly Shannon and Nancy Walls, was that inspirational for you?
That was a huge inspiration. And I thought that that was how it was. Like, I was like, this is how it always is. Just powerful women taking charge and being super funny all the time. It's not, but I was glad to see that and grow up with that. And yeah, Anna Gasteyer is like I love her so much. Amy Poehler.
Anna Gasteyer, great straight person.
Yes. Yeah.
Fantastic. It's such a quality that people don't realize how valuable and important it is. And then there's people like Molly Shannon, and again, I hope she wouldn't be mad if I said this. I don't think I would ever want to see her as a straight person. I don't want to see her moving the scene forward. I want to see the crazy.
Yeah.
So you're inspired, and then you get to school, and how do you find your muse? What is it that starts putting in your 10,000 hours?
Well, I was doing musicals in college, and then one of my directors was like, you should audition for the improv team here. And I did audition, didn't make it. And then I had another friend who auditioned 3 times and didn't make it. And I was like, and she was one of the funniest people, still is one of the funniest people I know. And still doing comedy. And I was like, that seems ridiculous. You should start your own group. And she was like, we should start our own group. So we started our own group, and it's still going at the school. And it was like a thing that we were doing for fun. And then the touring company for UCB came to my school my senior year. And it was Bobby Moynihan, Neil Casey, Shannon O'Neill, Lennon Parham. And my group and the other improv college group opened for them. And then afterwards, they did a Q&A with the student performers. And someone asked, how do you get a career in comedy? And Bobby Moynihan said, you move to New York, go to UCB, and work really hard. And I still have not forgotten that. And I moved to New York, and still not thinking that comedy was what I was aiming for. I was still trying to, like, do plays and Broadway, and I was auditioning for all these off-Broadway things, but still going to UCB and watching shows. And then after a couple of months, I was like, I should just take a class. Just try it, because I love it so much.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6
degrees of separation.
6 degrees of separation. I'm going to mention the name of somebody, just anything that comes to mind.
Okay.
Amy Poehler.
Happiness.
Tina Fey.
Smart.
Leslie Jones.
Joy.
Melissa McCarthy.
Powerhouse.
Amy Schumer.
Support.
Kate McKinnon.
Love.
Charlize Theron.
Ooh. Poise.
Lena Dunham.
Goofy.
Sarah Silverman.
Shining Star.
Amy Adams.
Sweetheart.
Scarlett Johansson.
Babe.
Kristen Wiig.
Multi-talented.
Dave Chappelle.
A force.
Chris Rock.
A leader.
Alec Baldwin.
Great.
Lorne Michaels.
The boss.
Awesome. Your proudest moment in show business.
I mean, this moment, like, being free, being doing what I want to do. This transition, this summer, has been my proudest moment.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening to the podcast. I want to talk to you about an amazing documentary that I worked on a few years back called I Killed JFK, which was unlike anything I ever did in my life. It centered on a man who'd been in prison for 30 years, was the only person in history to have admitted to killing Kennedy, and his story is unbelievable. He started as a runner for the mob. He was hired to drive two hitmen from that city around Dallas, and he ended up being the guy who calibrated their weapons, and he was there that day with one of his own and took the fatal shot that killed John F. Kennedy on the grassy knoll. His story, the footage, the interviews, never been seen before. You can't find them anywhere else except on this documentary. So go to BarryKatz.com to the merch page and buy the documentary with the rare interviews of the five greatest historical experts in the world, many of which you'll hear on the next 3 weeks of podcasts. So just go to BarryKatz.com, the merch page, pick up the documentary and interviews, and I guarantee it will reverse the way you feel about what happened that day in 1963 and change your opinion of the government and how it works and alter the way you think about things forever. Lastly, I want to talk to you about something really impactful, and it involves something really close to my heart: self-education. You see, throughout my life, I realized that every success I've ever achieved in my career has come from the education I received from my experiences in the business. And I truly believe that we all have the knowledge inside of us that others would kill for. And by sharing that, we can open up an entirely new world of possibilities for ourselves. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that I partnered up with my friend Tony Robbins, who's been number one in this field for 40 years. Along with his team of experts, Dean Graziosi and Russell Brunson, they'll show you how to take that valuable knowledge in your mind and turn it into an incredibly profitable mastermind, workshop, or event, just like they have and continue to do in their careers. And they're launching a new training program that's literally changing people's lives by helping people like you be a part of this $129 billion a year business. So it's an incredible opportunity for someone like yourself to build your own business, share your knowledge, and help and serve people in a huge way with the guidance of Tony Robbins, the best in the business. He's actually going to teach people like you how to make big money and build a successful business. So if you're ready to take your life to the next level, they're doing a free live training session today at BarryKBB.com. That's BarryKBB.com. Look, I've done over 440 free podcast episodes of Industry Standard, and because of your incredible response, it's reinforced my belief that we're morally obligated to share and pass on our knowledge with the world and help other people in those ways. I truly believe this, and I really love this groundbreaking training program and how it can turn your knowledge into an extraordinary amount of money. So just go to BarryKBB.com, that's BarryKBB.com, to this free training session with the best in the business, Tony Robbins. I guarantee you it will change your life forever. As always, this has been Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. And if you like the show, tell all your friends. And if you don't like the show, tell all your friends. You get out!
of money. Drive that fancy car. All the people love you, 'cause you're going far. Life is for the dreamers. They have all to gain. It's never quite over till it all feels the same. You pick your own poison, dig your own grave down in the valley. A fortune.
Thank you for listening to Industry Standard with Barry Katz. If you'd like more info on our schedule of new episodes or how to reach Barry through Twitter, Facebook, or email, go to BarryKatz.com. Before you leave, please take a moment to subscribe to our podcast, leave a comment, and rate it, even if you think it blows. Thank you for your support, and have a great day.